Here. Counselor Chapel?
Here.
Counselor Jordan?
Here.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Counselor Pearson?
Here. Thank you very much. At this point, I would ask you to all join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, at this point in our agenda, we have the minutes to review of our 12th meeting of the Town Council held on February 10th, 1992. Do I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I would move approval of the minutes as written.
Second motion.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Okay, 7-0 vote for approval. Thank you very much. At this point, I would like to take myself down to the podium. I have two resolutions this evening for our school champions, and by convention, because B comes before G, I'm going to ask the boys swimming and diving team to please come down here to the podium, please. Why don't you just kind of gather around in a little semicircle here so everyone who's watching tonight can see you all. Where's your coach?
He has a practice.
Okay. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School boys swimming and diving team recently won the Class A state championship for a second consecutive year, and whereas the team established a state record in the 200-yard freestyle relay and won the 200-yard medley, the 100-yard breaststroke, and the 400-yard relay, and whereas the citizens of Cape Elizabeth are proud of new coach Bill Poulos and the dedicated and determined young men on the team, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate Coach Bill Poulos and the boys' Class A state swimming and diving championship champions. And this is dated the 9th day of March 1992 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, and affixed with the names of all the 7 town councilors. Congratulations, gentlemen. Do you have a spokesman among you at all? Like to say a word or two? Go right ahead.
Well, we appreciate the support of everybody in Cape Elizabeth, and athletics is a bigger part of as our education as arts and sciences, and we definitely appreciate the support we get from everybody, and thank you very much for having all these resolutions for us, and we like them.
Thank you very much. Congratulations. Thank you. Thank you. And now, could I have the young women on the girls' swimming and diving team join me at the podium, please? Come on right around. Make sure everyone is seen here. Okay. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School girls' swimming and diving team recently won the Class A state championship, and whereas Cape Elizabeth ended Bangor's 5-year reign as state championship champions, and whereas the team's depth enabled the team to win with victories in the 200-yard medley relay and the 100-yard backstroke and with many strong finishes, and whereas the citizens of Cape Elizabeth are proud of new coach Bill Poulos and the dedicated and determined young women on the team, Now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate Coach Bill Poulos and the girls' Class A State Swimming and Diving Championships, dated this ninth day of March 1992 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine. And again, affixed with the seven signatures of the members of our Town Council. Congratulations, young women. And do you have a spokesperson?
We just like to thank all the parents, because without them, a lot of our accomplishments wouldn't have been met. And for the girls, we know this is a real special victory for us to defeat Bangor's five-year reign, and we'd just like to thank everybody.
Congratulations. Always a pleasure to recognize champions of our town. Wait a moment so people can exit and all right, let us proceed on the agenda to citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Are there individuals here this evening who would like to address the council? Any particular items that we do not have formally listed? Okay, seeing none, I will close that portion and proceed to the next, which is reports and correspondence. I would only mention this evening that our town manager is not with us. He is attending to responsibilities this evening that are associated with his position as vice president of the Maine Municipal Association. And in his stead, our town clerk is acting town manager, Ms. Debbie Pizzo, who will be with us this evening in the town manager's capacity. Other items, reports, and correspondence. No hands. No. Councilor McLaughlin, please.
I can't write and do this. Wait a second. Want to report that I did attend the February meeting of the COG Executive Committee. At that meeting, we had more or less a panel discussion of general assistance administrators, and we were fortunate in that our own general assistant administrator, Barbara Ray, was able to attend with me. These are very informative sessions that the COG Executive Committee is having these days. I find it helpful for me as a counselor to hear from staff people in a number of different positions. I believe this month we're going to be having the police departments represented. So it's a very worthwhile effort, I think, on COG's part to do that. One other thing I wanted to bring to the public's attention, and this is based on something that the council voted on last month. We were asked to look at our ordinance regarding multi-unit dwellings, conversions, and of having accessory apartments. That was referred to the ordinance committee, I believe, is what I see from the minutes of the last meeting. And because the council discussed this in workshop last week or recently, whenever, and there was a consensus of the councilors that we would not be dealing with that item at any level until litigation concerning that topic is resolved one way or another. So I just want people to know that it hasn't gone into the black hole of the ordinance committee, but it is basically put on hold for the time being because we are in litigation with an issue that relates directly to that part of the ordinance, and we do not want to harm the town's position.
If I could just make one clarification, Councillor McLaughlin, on actually what happened, because I don't want to give people the wrong impression. No vote was taken in workshop. We don't vote in a workshop. We only vote here at our regularly announced and noted council meetings, but it has been traditionally a town policy when litigation issues surface surrounding a particular issue that we don't pursue any changes until the litigation has been finalized. Other reports?
Also, are you going to talk about the Portland Water District?
Actually, I was not planning on talking about it.
Okay, I just wanted to bring that to the public's attention because we had so many residents in this community very willing to sign petitions we had last summer about the proposed rate increase and the rate structure of the Portland Water District. There is going to be a hearing this Thursday night, March 12th, at USM, I believe in the Law Building. Probably.
I don't think it's a Law Building. It's 7 o'clock.
Does anybody know where it is?
At the...
The Moot Court Room?
I think we have a... Does anyone have a map here?
Payson Smith. It's at Payson Smith.
Payson Smith Building.
Thank you. 7 o'clock Thursday night at Payson Smith Building on the USM campus. If any citizens would like to attend that, I think you'd be very welcome. You do not have to speak. You can just be there to show support. If you do want to speak to the rate increase and the rate structure, please, I would say you'd be advised to get in touch with Councillor Creelman, because we hope to have an organized presentation that evening. But I just want people to know that that is coming up. A lot of people had expressed an interest. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Jordan.
Well, I just want to bring up a point that kind of bothers me a little bit, that I'm appalled by the damage that was done on the school grounds down there after the swim meet, unless some of it was done after that, of the automobiles that have run over the lawns and the grasses, what have you. And I understand, and I wasn't there at this one, but I was handy to the last one that was there, and they were double parking on the street, and it was open enough for a vehicle, but they were parked on the lawn and what have you. And I feel, and no police were around, and they weren't even informed about the function either. So I think that we should bring up, when we meet with the school board, that they should come under the same rules as anybody else, as a basketball and what have you, to have their police available when they have a function like that. There was way too many people there. If they were all in that swimming pool at one time, or they, maybe they were running around the school, I don't know, but somebody tried to tell me there were 600 people there. But I don't see how they get in that swimming pool unless they stood 4 or 5 deep around the whole pool, so we can take it from there. I know the previous one, there were 3 or 4 buses in the parking lot, there was cars in the down, the parking lot down below, and they were double parked on the road going down back. And that is a hazard, and it should be corrected, and they should understand it, and I shall bring it up with our meeting with the school board.
Thank you, Councillor Jordan. Other information issues? Yes, Councillor Chappell.
I've been to 2 meetings of RWD, Regional Waste Services, since RWS, since the last time that I reported to you. And just for the record, the last Board and Finance Committee meeting, we looked over the Gorham facility and how far we should go with it, with the tonnage that is now reported to us as being available with the slowdown of the economy and so forth. And it was a unanimous decision of the Board and Finance Committee that it be referred to the full board to stop that for 1 year, as it was. The only thing we're going forward with is to get our 2 permits. There's 2 left, one from DEP and one from the wetlands, and the other one, I don't remember now, but there's only 2 left. I'm going over Wednesday at 2 o'clock and represent our town manager at a meeting at RWS on sludge figures for Cape Elizabeth and South Portland for new contracts. I'll report to you on that on the next meeting.
Thank you very much. Any other reports or correspondence? Okay.
I just hope that there are interested citizens out there who would like to join us up here. We have 2 positions in the town council that are up for re-election, one for re-election and the other is going to be left open by Councilor Amaral. So we'd like to have interesting campaign and hope the citizens will come forward and take out the applications at Town Hall.
Indeed, there are, I understand there are also two school board seats open, and by all means, anyone interested in running for the school board, please come by, and Ms. Pizzo can provide you with the appropriate forms to obtain your 25 signatures. Is that, it goes the same way for the school board, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Any other information in this part of the agenda? Okay, seeing none, we will end reports and correspondence. And the first item on the regular section is the public hearing on leaf burning, leaf and brush burning. This is item 132, and it's to consider a proposed amendment to the Fire Protection Code, which would prohibit leaf and brush burning within 200 feet of a principal structure not owned by the applicant, and we should take appropriate action. At this point, I would just defer to the chair of our ordinance committee, Councillor Cogsell, and then I will also ask our fire department representative. Is he here? Oh, yes, he is. Good. I'll ask Mr. Gleason if he has any thoughts, and then I'll open the public hearing up to the public. Phyllis?
Thank you. The ordinance committee decided to study this issue again after we had several complaints and serious appeals from citizens in heavily populated areas about the burning of leaves, and particularly in areas where there are people who have respiratory problems. We as a town have been trying to encourage and have the facility available for leaf composting, and composting can also be done quite easily at your own home. So we did take that all into consideration and discussed it with a fire chief, acting fire chief, and with our planner as to what would be the best approach. Burning of leaves and brush is necessary as part of the maintenance of large tracts of land and agricultural land, so we didn't think it would be fair to ban it completely. So it basically restricts the burning to more open areas in the town.
Thank you very much. Deputy Chief Gleason, would you like to make any comments on this proposed amendment at this time? All right, fine. Thank you very much. At this point, then, I will open the issue to the public. Are there individuals here in attendance this evening who would like to speak to this issue? Please come right down and be kind enough to state your name and address.
Thank you. My name is Tom Heels. I live at 9 Rocky Knoll Road, and I've lived there for 20 years. And my wife and I have been victims, I would say, of offensive leaf burning in the neighborhood, and we are in favor of this amendment to the ordinance that came up. And had I known of the ordinance committee meeting taking place, I would have attended it. Since November meeting that I attended here, I haven't heard of any other meeting concerning this issue, so I didn't know it was coming up until I read about it in the Cape Courier. And I think there's many, many good reasons that this should be passed, and amongst them is just that it is definitely a hazard to people with burning leaves and the ashes from them blowing around with unattended fires. It's a health hazard, and I'm very glad that the Ordinance Committee has taken this step to recommend this. My next door neighbor regretfully couldn't be here, and she gave me a statement to read, if you'd allow me to read this. To town council members, regretfully I cannot be at the meeting tonight, but I want to express my opinion regarding leaf burning, particularly in an area such as Oakhurst, where the houses are very close to each other. I am highly allergic to many pollens and particularly sensitive to the irritants contained in smoke from burning leaves. The smoke contributes greatly to air pollution in the neighborhood, and many times when there are numerous large piles of leaves being burned, I am forced to remain indoors not only because of an allergic reaction, but also because there are often our sparks flying through the air from these fires. I require allergy injections monthly on a year-round basis. And the smoke from leaf burning further aggravates an already difficult condition for me. Please ban leaf burning in such areas as Oakhurst and others. Thank you. This is from Mary Drake, my next door neighbor at 11 Rocky Knoll Road. So the two of us, as two neighbors, have spoken on this issue. We're in favor of this amendment to the ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Heels. Are there others who would like to address this proposed change? Please, sir, come right down.
Good evening. My name is Don Burrows, and I live at 19 Old Fort Road. We have a lot of trees, and I dread leaf season every year because it's so much work. And if the wind is blowing the wrong way, we get the leaves from our neighbors' trees. Sometimes they get ours, sometimes we get theirs. The leaf pickup that the town does always seems to end when only about half the leaves are off the trees. And to me, that's a problem because putting them out to be picked up is one of the few things that I can think of to do with them. So I'm basically against the ordinance at this point. We have neighbors all around us, and they all burn leaves. And to me, burning leaves is a smell of fall, and it always has been. Certainly, if people have conditions, they could make arrangements whereby if their neighbor's going to burn, they could, you know, be out of town, or somehow they could get together and work that out. I can understand if people are allergic that it's unfortunate, and I can imagine how they must feel. But I've lived in the town for only 6.5 years, so I'm a relative newcomer. But I hate to see the change taking place whereby we're getting more and more antiseptic and less of a nice little rural or semi-rural neighborhood. So I am therefore against the ordinance. If something could be done to maybe give people some reasonable alternative, such as my wife is from Elmira, and they just pile their leaves in the gutter, and the big truck comes by with a big vacuum and just sucks them all up and takes them away, and I don't know what happens to them. That would be very nice. Or maybe if the leaf pickup could be extended until most of the leaves are off the trees. I understand there's a problem getting close to snow, dealing with the snow time, but if they would extend that pickup until later, until most of the leaves were down, that would be a help. So anything like that that could, you know, work around it, that would be fine. But basically, as I understand the ordinance reads, I'm against it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your input. Others? Please come right down.
My name is Bill Riley. I live at 75 Hillcrest Road. I've been a Cape resident since 1973. I echo many of the concerns of my fellow citizen who was just at the podium. I am also against the ordinance, perhaps for some slightly different reasons. In addition to what he said, I think this is an example of the middle class once again getting squeezed by too much government regulation. I, for one, cannot afford to hire someone to bag my leaves for me, haul them to the dump. I certainly can't afford for the services of a vacuum truck to come by and pick them up. I don't have the time either to bag them and pick them up. If the town was willing to offer an alternative, such as taxpayer-supported leaf pickup and extending the season with a vacuum truck, I'd certainly be amenable to that. As an environmentalist, I don't understand the 200-foot rule at all. We're either going to ban burning or we're not. I don't think it should be a luxury afforded those people that have the 5-acre lots. So I feel, as a middle-class person, I feel a little bit squeezed in that respect. I do have a child and a wife who also have asthma problems. When we're burning, they choose to stay inside. A couple of my neighbors also have children with asthma. They also burn. Their children manage to survive quite nicely. So my recommendation would be either totally eliminate burning and provide us with a reasonable alternative that we can afford, or keep government out of it and let Maine stay the way it's been since I've been a Cape resident. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Riley. Others?
My name is Clint Blood. I live at 63 Hillcrest Road. I've been a resident here since 1975. I'm pyro. I like to burn. Fully admit that. And I support two people previous to me and what they have said. I'd like to add a couple other things, though. One is the sense of community that comes out of actually burning leaves. If you're burning leaves in November, it's kind of chilly. People come out and they like to stand around the fire, and we all talk. The kids stand around. They watch the acorns pop. It's a community type of activity. And I really do think that the current rules, if they're enforced, are adequate. I also understand the asthma and that type of situation. And before coming here this evening, I gave a person a ride to a church, and they made a recommendation because they happen to have asthma. And it was in Massachusetts, I believe, and maybe your ordinance committee has already considered this, would be to sort of a compromise. You'd allow burning, but only allow burning, say, from November 10th through December 1st. The reason for this is, as she pointed out, was that the leaves have basically all come off the trees at that point in time, that the smoke is not caught in the leaves of the trees. In other words, when you start burning in September, it's warmer out. People may have their windows open for asthma and medical conditions. If they wish to keep their windows open in November when it's 40 degrees out, well, that's their choice. But it would also allow us to burn the leaves, to have the enjoyment of burning the leaves, also not to have to be trucking back and forth, because we really do have piles of leaves that come down. And I think that trying to pick them up by the town in terms of a leaf picker-upper, it's pretty going to be a pretty expensive operation if you look at Oakhurst at all. And so I just thought that if maybe you've already considered that as an alternative, but I thought it was an alternative that might be a possibility in terms of middle ground. So allow us to burn the leaves. They all would basically have come down, you know, roughly by in November. You'd be cutting out burning in September and October. And that way it would be a compromise, and maybe that would satisfy both factions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blood. Others? Okay. Seeing no further hands, I will close the section of the hearing to the public and bring it back for consideration and discussion among councillors. Is there input? Councillor Pearson.
Yes, Chairman Krillman, I was going to ask my fellow councillors if I could be excused due to a perceived conflict with one aspect of my business, this issue.
Is there any problem with excusing Councillor Pearson from the discussion and vote on this item?
No problem with me.
No problem.
No.
Anything, Jane or Merv?
No, I have no problem.
Okay, you are excused. Carl, thank you. Let us proceed with our discussion at this point. Councillor McLaughlin, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to pass on to the council comments I've received from two citizens in the past couple of days. One gentleman spoke to me about his concern with the proposed wording we have before us this evening. He lives on Shore Road near St. Albans Church on the water side of the road and said he burns down on the beach, but he probably was within 200 feet of somebody else's residence. Another gentleman has asked what would happen if two or three or four neighbors got together and got a joint permit, and I need to, that's what I thought, you cannot get a joint permit. It's per person, per household or whatever, so you can't get a joint permit, so that was that idea. Oh, okay, so four people in a row.
They can all fall into one yard, but there's only one permit. If you can't get a permit for a neighbor, there's no one.
It's for one fire, but, and that one fire would have to be, if we had the lang, if we adopted the language before us this evening, then that fire would have to be, still have to be 200 feet from the neighbor who may have brought his leaves over, but could only have one name on the permit. So that, thank you, that clarifies it for me.
Thank you.
Those comments.
Other input on this issue? Counselor Amaro.
I'd like to ask the ordinance committee to explain to us why they chose the 200 feet. How did you come to that measurement?
The planner proposed a couple of different distances, and we spent a great deal of time that evening trying to decide whether it's 200 feet or it was 100 feet. And we ultimately felt that 100 feet is not that great a distance in a more heavily developed area. So we finally came up with the 200. If I could just make a comment to Mr. Heels, that the ordinance committee meetings usually are published each week. There is a little calendar that says which committees are meeting in which different towns. And usually our meeting is published in there. We meet once a month whenever we all can get together. It's not always the same date each month. Also, we did at one point consider the time frame, Mr. Blood. And burning late in the early part of December might work in Massachusetts, but here sometimes we've had snow. And we still have to wait for the oak leaves to come down. Hopefully they are by the beginning of December. And we thought that might be a little harder to enforce. So we went with the more generic type of situation where if the leaves need to be burned, if it's late October, then you could burn them in late October so they don't blow all over everyone's yard.
Thank you. Thank you for the clarification. Counselor Jordan.
Yes, I, as a member of the ordinance committee, and kind of went along with this to start with, but the more I thought about it and the questions that I've had in the last few days, I think the ordinance committee should take another look at it, because I don't feel that it's going to work as well as they thought it might to start with. It might work in build-up areas, but there are areas that I drew a picture here tonight to my fellow counselors, and the guy has a fairly long, deep lot, and he would have a job to start a fire within that and not be within 200 feet of his neighbor. And I think we need to take another look at it.
Chairman?
Please,
I also agree with Councilor Jordan that I think we should refer it back to the ordinance committee to take another look. And the thing that bothers me is what I've heard from the people when they read the 200 feet mark, and gosh, you take most any building in Shore Acres or Oakhurst or even Broad Cove or any of them, you start measuring 200 feet, nobody's going to burn. And this does bother me a little bit that we're making it too restrictive. I think you'd have to admit that if it's 200 feet is ever passed, you're cutting out leaf burning in about probably 95% of the case, as far as houses go. Not land, but as far as houses go. I think the fire department would support us on that if we ask them. And I think that's a little bit too restrictive for what we want. We do want to put something on the books, I feel, that helps on this leaf burning, very definitely. But I think we've got to be careful what we use for a footage mark. 100 foot, you take the corner of most houses, and most lots of it, I think it would be figured from the corner of the lot, would it not? Or from where the fire was. Well, that's what we've got to make sure of. If I got a 150-foot lot, I put a fire in the middle of it, I got 75 foot both sides, I can't have any house within 25 foot of the corner of my lot. They are on both sides, so I'm done. I can't have any fires, even on a 150-foot lot. I wonder how many people are in the same position. So we've got to be careful. I'd move that we refer this back for them to just look at this 200 foot.
Second motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Further discussion, Councilor Amaro.
I'd like to also ask that if we refer this back to the ordinance committee, that they be asked to look at a couple of other areas once again, too, besides just the 200-foot idea. I think we ought to look at when we do pick up leaves in this town, if maybe we can adjust that. I know we've talked about that before, but it seems like we don't very often get snow in October any that early anymore. It's very, very rare. I think we ought to think about our cleanup season being later in the season. And also, I like the idea that Clint came up with. I think we ought to give it a little bit more thought, Phyllis, about having a certain time only when permits for burning leaves would be issued. And I think that if we did look at later in maybe not issuing any permits until at least November, that might be a help. So I'd like to ask the audience committee if they would take another look at those areas as well as the 200-foot setback.
Councillor Cogsell.
I'd like to ask Councillor Jordan what other questions he had asked of him recently.
The questions he was asked me is leaves and brush is two different things, and you don't get the smoke and whatever from the brush as you do the leaves. And I think I brought that up at the ordinance committee meeting that we had. It's too different unless you put green brush on. And I would just like to take another look at it, because I think if you figure out that you've got to have a pretty big lot to be able to have any kind of leaf burning, and I think the time deal would have a lot to do with it, and it would help it out. I understand what the gentleman has as far as, you know, the smoke and what have you to a lot of people, and I understand that 100%, but I don't feel that we should cut other people out if there's another way of doing it. Maybe we got to have a real leaf pickup deal, but if it's going to cost money, I don't think you'll see that this year.
Okay, well, it looks like there seems to be a fair amount of consensus. I'm just going to offer a dissenting view. I'm personally against leaf burning at all. I think it's a public health hazard. I don't want to go into any great debate on that, since I'm pretty much looks like 5-1 on this issue. But I do want to go down in the record as saying that I was prepared to vote for this revised ordinance tonight, I will vote against this motion, as I believe that the ordinance committee has thought out the issue. We were presented with most of the arguments that were presented this evening several months ago, and I quite honestly feel that we're paralyzing our ordinance committee by returning to it virtually every single amendment that we try to pass as a council. And it concerns me, because we've really, I think our ordinance committee has become paralyzed. I think there's certainly the opportunity for open debate, and we have all of our ordinance committee meetings publicized, but it does seem to me over the last 4 years that our ordinance committee actually is successfully doing less and less as a consequence of going over the same issue time and time and time again. So that, I just want to go on record and give that particular probable dissenting opinion. Councillor Cogsell.
Well, I too was ready to vote in favor of the ordinance change tonight, because during our meeting we did discuss these different issues, and we felt the consensus of the ordinance committee was that for health reasons, leaf burning in the densely populated areas was not beneficial to really anyone. As a health professional and one who deals with asthmatics and reads a lot of articles on secondhand smoke, whether smoking or leaf burning, I believe that it should not be allowed in densely populated neighborhoods. And I'm going to vote that this not be returned to the ordinance committee.
Counselor McLaughlin.
One other statement.
I'm sorry, go right ahead.
Well, also the fact that this was on our agenda last month when it was first set for public hearing this month, and nothing was said by other councilor members or the general public, and it might have been much more beneficial if something had been said last month and we could have acted on it then. It'd be nice if we could have something in place by the burning season.
Counselor McLaughlin, I saw your hand.
I'm sure we'll have something in place by the burning season. But, and I appreciate the comments from the two previous councilors have made. I would support removing the brush burning from the language before us. And I agree with Councilor Jordan, that's a concern of mine too, that if we have a spring storm or an early fall storm, a late summer storm, when tree branches, sometimes whole trees are coming down and people have a large enough lot to burn that brush without having it offend the neighbors, I think that's fine. And Councilor Coggeshall is right, we have discussed a lot of these suggestions already at the Ordinance Committee level. And I don't know that I would change my mind with more discussion about them. I'm very aware of the concerns of people who have a lot of trees on their property. I don't have many trees on my property, but I certainly get a lot of leaves from other people's trees. And I do not burn because I have adequate space for composting. I do that on my lot. I did hear comments this evening about this being a community type of activity. And I don't want this council to get in the middle of a neighborhood squabble, which I think there is the potential to have happen possibly because the town may have been remiss in not carrying out proper enforcement of the building permits that have been issued. Because we've heard from people complaining about their neighbors. That is not a community building activity when we have people complaining about their neighbors. So I'm concerned about that kind of comment and the comments I've heard on the other side of that issue. I think we've come up with a viable solution to the concerns we've heard in the past and the concerns we've heard this evening. Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
I think there's on the books right now that if somebody is doing some burning and it's a nuisance to their neighbor, they can be made to put it out if the fire department wants to go down and enforce it.
Councilor Amaral.
I understand the frustration of the Ordinance Committee because certainly we have, as a council, sent ordinances back and back and back again. However, I think it's the process that we use in this town that really works. And I don't envy people who serve on the Ordinance Committee because I think it's the toughest committee in town to serve on. And it is a lot of work. However, we bring an ordinance change to the council's attention at the first reading and then set it for public hearing. And I think it's really important that we do this process, that people come before us, and that after listening to them, that if suggestions are made that seem to make sense, that we ought to look into them further. And I think that's why our process does take a long time, but it is very responsive to people's input. And I would agree with Councilor Jordan that I think the ordinance we have on the book, if enforced, would work very well. And to me, it's an enforcement issue, more than trying to come up with more regulations. And I also think it's an educational issue of talking with people in town, maybe doing major educational efforts through the Cape Courier as to the problems that burning does create for other people. And I'd really rather give us a chance, I guess, once more to try to enforce the ordinance that we have presently and to do, in the fall, a substantial educational process for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth about leaf burning.
Is there other comments or further discussion on this particular motion, Councillor Cogswell? I saw your hand first.
I just wanted to let people know that before we had our meeting, we did discuss with the police department as well as with the acting fire chief and a former fire chief about the enforcement. And they said whenever they've heard or received any calls with problems, they have followed up on them. When they have seen something, if someone's been traveling through the town and it looked like they were unsupervised fires or whatever, they've acted upon it. So they've enforced when they've been asked to or they've seen a need to it to be done. James.
Well, I did see Janet's hand first. I was not looking over there yet.
We're giving the chairman neck problems, I'm sure, here. I would like to get a feeling from other counselors of how many would be supportive of leaving the current language, not what's before us tonight, but the existing language with no changes. If, and instructing both the fire department and police department to diligently carry out the enforcement of the permits issued under the existing language.
Well, you know, I'd like to perhaps ask Peter Gleason, would you come up to the podium? Because this has been a major dilemma for the council and I think for the citizens in that my understanding is that it's extremely difficult to enforce the existing language.
Acting upon a complaint hasn't been a problem. It creates a problem when you meet with the citizen and they say, well, I've been given a permit, and you explain to them that there have been complaints on it and we need to have the fire extinguished. If we receive a complaint, you know, whether it be from offensive smoke or whatever, and we go down, we do have it extinguished. I think that the problem is caused by the people not understanding that we can't have it extinguished if it is, in effect, bothering someone or whatever.
Beyond that, would it be possible to not, you know, have to just wait for a complaint? I mean, we know who have been issued permits. Couldn't we do some sort of a check on people who have permits given up to them?
Most of the time we rely on the police department as they're patrolling the town. If they see a problem, they will speak with the individual. If they have any problems, they then call one of the officers, fire officers, to come down and...
But if that actually became the responsibility of someone of a policeman on duty would be to patrol each, you know, where permits had been issued to make sure.
They do a very good job.
Rather than just going by.
And when they are on patrol encountering the leaves, they've done a very good job of controlling the problems. I think they've done, you know, they've been a lot of help to us, saved us from having to, you know, leave our houses to go check on it. Most of the problems we get as far as leaf burning or nuisance, it's not related to fire dangers or anything, or fires getting out of control. It's more complaints from smoke.
Captain Williams, can you enlighten us in any capacity as our recognized chief law enforcement officer in this group?
we will act on any complaint, that's what we do.
Microphone.
We like to see up the mic. Come on. Look good.
I'm here only as a spectator, not necessarily representing the police department. However, we do act on any complaint that we receive, and we handle it accordingly. We don't necessarily call the fire department out for everything. Mm-hmm. The only problem I can foresee is what is smoky to the police officer might not be, or it might not be smoky to the police officer, but might be smoky to a citizen. Mm-hmm. That's a judgment call.
I guess please, a question counsel. For Peter. Don't go too far, Nick.
He doesn't know.
He does now. For the public, Mr. Williams is here because his son is here for a civics class, I believe. Yes. Nice of you to accompany him. Peter, when the permits are issued, is there a time frame on them?
Yes.
Okay, so a complaint could very logically come in after the time frame of the permit. Okay, I believe I've heard cases of that happening. The smoky smoldering has persisted after the end of the permit. That's one major complaint that I've heard of in the past. I don't know how it's been dealt with. Of course, sometimes when I've gone to put out a smoldering situation, I've created more smoke in the process. What happens when you put it out at that stage?
It's a lot of steam and smoke when you put it out. Yeah. Okay. It's mostly steam.
Okay. So I think that's one place that we have some definite criteria for dealing with a complaint. I appreciate Nick's concern that, you know, what smoke to one person may not be smoke to another person, may not be as offensive to another person. Are there any other specific criteria like that that are enforceable?
As far as, when you're given the permit, you're given conditions, you have to have hoses, rakes, adults in supervision, other fire and that sort of stuff, and those are what we key on in enforcing. If there's nobody in attendance of the burn, that's a major concern for us.
Okay. But it's not reasonable for us to do anything about the amount of smoke or anything like that. And I know when I asked, I think, Jimmy Murray about if he'd ever seen a leaf burning that wasn't smoky, he assured me he had not.
No. So. Fire and smoke go hand in hand.
Yeah, thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
See, there's one problem that arises here. Somebody come in 8 o'clock in the morning and get a permit to do some burning. By 10 o'clock, the wind could come up and lay the smoke into the neighbor. Somebody gets down and they get in a hassle because I got a permit. And this is what you get going back and forth. But if you're persistent, they'll put it out.
How about other clarifications? Okay, there is a motion. Billy?
Would you care to let him speak? Gentleman
out there. No, the public hearing is okay. Over. I'm sorry. I'm not going to. Okay. I'm not going to allow any more public input other than our appointed officials in the department. And I don't. Do we have any more specific questions for either police or fire at this particular time?
Ready for the question.
Okay. So I think. Go ahead, Councilor McLaughlin. Further discussion.
Before going to the question before us, I would like the. A nodding of the head consensus of some sort about how counselors feel about the existing language. If we, you know, as I said, instruct the police and fire department to be very diligent with enforcement, that will affect my vote on the motion. How many of you would like to see us keep the existing language without putting anything new in it, without this restriction on the 200 feet?
The enforcement.
With the enforcement.
Go with that.
Well, I prefer the new language.
Okay.
I prefer the new language also because the police and fire feel they are enforcing the ordinance as it now stands. And it's not solving the problem.
Councilor Chappell?
I prefer the new language, but the 200 feet bothers me.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so the motion is to essentially refer this amendment back to the Ordinance Committee. It's been seconded. We've got plenty of discussion on it. All those in favor? 3 votes. All those opposed? 3 votes. Okay, the motion does not carry. Is there a desire by anyone to propose an additional motion? Councilor Cogsell.
I move that we accept the amendment as proposed.
Is there a second? I'll second it. Okay, there is a motion and a second. Is there any discussion on this particular item at this point? All those in favor of the motion? 3 votes. All those opposed? We have 3 votes. The motion does not carry. At this point, I think we have a dead issue.
Councilor.
I'm not sure we have the opportunity to get a 7th vote. I think we'll have to table it for the moment. I don't know if there's any other language that anyone is interested in proposing on this item. I think the item stands as is. Next item on the agenda tonight is, it's the second public hearing on construction monitoring. This is item 133, and it is to consider a proposed amendment to the subdivision ordinance, which would enable subdivision construction monitoring services to be provided by a monitor other than the original design engineer or landscape architect, and take any necessary action. At this time, I will again defer the item before opening it up to public hearing to the chair of our ordinance committee, Councilor Cogsell.
Thank you. This amendment was requested by the town manager to provide the town with greater flexibility in the choice of construction monitor for new developments. The existing ordinance requires that the construction monitor paid for by the developer must be in the employ of the project's design engineer. This should lend continuity between planning and construction phases. However, it is possible that someone unfamiliar with a project could be assigned as the construction monitor. And this amendment would allow the developer to hire a construction monitor not affiliated with a design engineer firm if that person was acceptable to the town manager. This amendment makes it possible for professional construction monitors that are not affiliated with an engineering firm to be selected. It has been a case in the past that an individual who is either a student or the son of someone in the construction company would be the one to monitor the construction, and we just feel that it's not a good policy. So we propose that we change section 16.2.6, inspection of required improvements, to add the new language: the construction monitor shall either be under the employ of the project design engineer or landscape architect as stated on the approved plans. And then it goes on that, or an experienced construction monitor to be approved by the town manager and employed by the owner. It goes on to also say, under the record drawing shall be based on field logs of the construction monitor and bear the professional seal of a design engineer or landscape architect. And the old language is retained.
Thank you very much, Phyllis. Okay, I think this has been explained in sufficient detail such that I will now open item 133 to public input. Are there any individuals this evening who would like to come forward and speak, either for or against our construction monitoring public hearing? Okay, seeing none, I will then close this portion of the public hearing and bring it back for debate on the council. Councilor Cogsell.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the amendment as proposed.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor? The vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Okay, we've concluded the public hearings for this evening. We'll now proceed to item number 134. This is to consider several requests for the use of Fort Williams Park during 1992 and take any necessary action. At this time, I will defer to our acting town manager, Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you very much. The town manager has provided you with a list of recommended 1992 summer events for the fort. These have gone before the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and have been approved. I'll just take a quick minute to go over them. The Easter sunrise on April 19th, high school graduation on June 12th, family fun day June 13th, Portland Symphony Orchestra July 3rd, 17th, and 31st, the schedule for Cape Elizabeth Little League, a walkthrough for the main chapter of multiple sclerosis, Secretary of State's conference on August 11th, the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department Art Show on September 6th, and a British car show on September 13th. The manager has listed parking fees and certificates of insurance where applicable. Also, he asked me to note that if there are churches that come before the manager asking to use the fort for the Easter sunrise, that he be able to approve that without coming back through the process of the council. We would recommend that you approve these requests.
Okay, thank you very much. Discussion. Anybody have any problems with any of these proposed dates or the couple of rain dates that Debbie did not mention, but I believe were pretty much the following days, weren't they? The rain date on Family Fun Day would be
June 14th,
right? And then the car show had a rain date of September 7th.
Yes.
1992.
Engine one has that date.
Engine one. I see a hand back there. Clint, come on right down to the podium. Help clarify anything as a long-standing contributor to these issues.
I only speak, I'm just a member of the Fort Williams Commission. I'm not speaking here on behalf of the Fort Williams Commission, but I have contacted four members of the Fort Williams Commission. And on our mailing, which we received Thursday or Friday, was the first time that we had heard officially or through Mike's or Mr. McGovern's note that Family Fun Day had been approved by Fort Williams Commission. The past 2 years, it has not come before the commission. We are not in opposition to Family Fun Day, but we do believe there's a process that is not being taken by this one group. All other groups have come before us, including school administrators, parents, students. For example, the project graduation or graduation usually comes with any number of people to present their points of view and how they're going to set their program up. So we assume that Family Fun Day is going to be okay, but we really don't know because we don't know anything what they're doing. And we didn't last year either. So I only speak to the process that if, in fact, you wish the committee to do its work, that we should at least require other town committees to come before us if we're going to require other school organizations and other private organizations to come before us also. So we have no idea in terms of the report what they're planning on doing or anything. We have not received any letters from them or no one has come before our committee. Our next commission meeting is April 2nd. And I'm not suggesting that we have to postpone the vote for that. I mean, but I would like, if it maybe could be put in, that they could please come before us and explain what they're going to do, because maybe they're, in past years, they've had groups come in that have had open pit fires. You know, we don't know anything about anything from porta potties to whether or not they're having animals come in and giving animal rides. We have absolutely no idea. So we don't want this to come back on the commission to say, well, you know, you gave your approval. We did not give approval because we have not been approached by them. So I would only hope that you'd realize that process has not worked with that particular group. The process has worked with all the other groups, and we strongly support, you know, their position. Thank you.
Clint, I'm just confused for a moment here. In the minutes of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, it says that January 23rd minutes, the commission passed a motion to approve the project graduation date subject to a request to tighten the schedule, if possible, to be in the park at noon and out by 7 p.m., and also subject to presentation and approval by the town manager and town council. What happened there?
Okay, we were anticipating, quite honestly, from a Fort Williams Commission standpoint, it would be great to have Family Fun Day some other weekend other than graduation. It would work out a lot better probably for a lot of people, but they have their reasons, which I can't speak to because I'm not on that commission. But we assumed that they would be coming in that same weekend. So when project graduation or graduation came before us, one of the issues was to make sure they could leave in time, because there are certain town groups that like to come in at 1 o'clock on Friday to set their booths up, which we did not want to allow that, because they would be setting up right where right where graduation takes place. So we were assuming they were going to come before us, because in January of each year, and we advertised it this year in the Cape Courier, we asked that groups that who are going to be using the fort, this is the first time that we can set up a schedule for this year. We can't set up in October or November. We always set up in January. So we assume that they'd be coming before us, but we have not. Again, it may be an oversight on Mr. McGovern's side. I tried to call him today. I didn't realize he was in Washington. I didn't think I'll call you, Deborah, but because I had talked with other, including Randall Weil, the chairman, on it. Just a concern. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Thanks, Mr. Blood. Is there, by any chance, is there anyone from the school this evening empowered to discuss this issue? Well, the school to make a formal request. I'm just wondering if anyone is in that capacity.
Family Fun Day. But the school is a problem too, is it?
No.
We're just
Family Fun Day.
Let us speak.
Go right ahead. Go right ahead.
Hi, my name is Heather Scott, and myself and my other student, Sarah Michael, are the co-chairman of project graduation, graduation ceremonies, And the graduating class of 1992 is requesting the use of the Fort Williams on June 12th from noon till 7 p.m. And the ceremony will be from 3 to 5 with a short reception up at the pavilion following, like a half hour, hour at the most. And the juniors, who we have as the class marshals, they would go 2 hours before their ceremony, set up the chairs, and afterwards, while the seniors are at the reception, they take down the chairs. Now, in previous years, talking with other chair people of the committee, they said, you know, it's never been a problem of clearing down the chairs for the Family Fun Day, which is usually fall the day after, that the ceremony has been finished in time and the chairs have been taken down. And
well, thank you very much. You, on the one hand, you got a little free advertising here and publicity for the event. And just out of curiosity, did any one of your group, did you talk to the Family Fun Day people at all outside of any of the official channels here?
No, we did not.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for the clarification. Okay. Well, what is the will of the council at this particular time regarding this item? Councilor McLaughlin. Okay, the official date is September 13th, and there is a rain date that, Bill, you also discussed with the commission?
September.
Of the 20th of September. Okay, can we so note that that addition then in the request?
You said it said the 19th in minutes.
Is that okay with everyone?
It's, I don't know if Clint Blood can confirm or not, but in the minutes it does refer to it 19th. It is definitely the 20th that you wanted versus the 19th. Yeah, no, the 20th.
That would be a week from the 13th.
Yeah. It just has the 19th. That's why I was wondering if there was something else scheduled. That.
Yeah, that's a Sunday.
So rain, we will make that correction 20th. Then with the, okay. On the British Car Show, the rain date is September 20th, the following Sunday. Okay. All right, do I, Councilor McLaughlin?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank Heather for the presentation tonight. I did, after receiving this in our packets, I talked to a number of people about the graduation plans. I'm glad to see you're having, tentatively have the reception after graduation back in there. I know a lot of people in the community enjoy that time. It's the last time those of us who don't have seniors or aren't going to a senior's home for a private celebration have to say goodbye to some of the kids we've become very fond of, and I hope that will be able to happen. I like that part. I'm glad you can probably do it. And all the people I spoke to seem to think that 7 o'clock was giving you plenty of time for your knockdown in light of anticipating Family Fun Day folks getting in there to do their setup. I'm distressed to hear that Family Fun Day has not been in touch with the Fort Williams Commission. I know when we was it 2 or 3 years ago when I was on appointments committee, and we had some very long and serious discussions about the timing of Family Fun Day, the potential conflict with graduation, and we're trying to impress upon people the need for cooperation between the two groups. Those are two very important functions in this community. There's potential for a problem because they happen on the same weekend, but I think if we can get back into a good cooperative framework, that's going to continue to work well for everybody. One other concern I had when I received this information was about the sign for the Portland Symphony activities. I know, I think maybe because I feel a bit possessive about the sign ordinance from my history here. Last year when that sign went up, a number of complaints were put forth to different counselors and to staff about the size of the sign. And the language before us tonight says the symphony would have a sign at the Fort entrance from June 27th to July 21st, the sign to be approved by the town manager and to be smaller than last year. That sign also will need a permit from the code enforcement officer. It will be a temporary sign. This is not to indicate that The symphony will bypass any of the sign ordinance requirements. So anybody paying attention for the symphony, please be aware that you need to go to the code enforcement officer as well as the manager for that sign. And I certainly do hope the sign will be smaller than it was last year. And code enforcement officer has assured me it will be.
Thank you, Councilor McLaughlin. I guess, you know, the only thing I want to perhaps suggest, Mr. McGovern and I went over the agenda in some detail prior to tonight's meeting, and unfortunately he's not here this evening to fill in perhaps information that we didn't cover. It's possible that the representatives of Family Fun Day did bring this up with him in some capacity, and the communication just, you know, has not gotten back to us. If that's true, you know, we're sort of talking about an item of ignorance, in all honesty. If it isn't, then your comments hold. But it would seem to me that the most reasonable thing to do would be to authorize this situation, you know, currently. If it's the wrong day, we can certainly revoke the authorization, but let it go on record that we need to have the formal dialogue for future dates, because on that particular, you know, the two next to each other, it is a real squeeze play, and every year I think there's a lot more stress than maybe needs to be if we could figure something out that separated it a bit better. Councilor Jordan.
Yeah, I just have one comment. As far as Family Fun Day goes, in favor of Family Fun Day, but I don't like the idea that $2 parking fee with the proceeds going to Family Fun Day, because I don't think that, how can they come up with a budget if they don't know how many cars are going in there? And we have X number of dollars in our budget. I think they should propose a budget and these $2 go into the general fund like they do for any other concert and what have you, come back. To me, they can't put a budget together with estimating how many cars are going in there with a $2 fee. And I feel that isn't the right way to do it. They should present us with a budget, and we approve the budget as X number of dollars, and they go forward with that, and then they know what they got to work with. I think this is a poor way to do it.
Councilor McLaughlin.
In response to that, Councilor Jordan, I believe that $2 parking fee would go towards their budget for the next year.
It doesn't say that here.
But that, I believe that's what the policy is.
If fees come in from other things at a certain rate and go into the general fund, why shouldn't these go in the general fund? And then they come up with a budget for the following year like anybody else does.
Councilor Cogsell.
I believe that the when we approved the policy of parking fees that they were all supposed to, we didn't make an exception for any group, so that it probably should proceed to the general fund.
Is there a general feeling that perhaps we need to amend this evening's recommendations to account for this discrepancy? Is there strong feeling by most that the proceeds ought to go into the general fund? Councilor Amaral, did you have?
Yeah, I agree that they should go into the general fund, but I also think we should keep a record so that it's noted each budget year how much money does come in from the parking, so that helps us in making budgetary decisions, I think.
Agree with that 100%.
Okay.
So moved.
We'll move that then, and do we have, should we vote on that then, just to amend the $2 parking fee under Family Fun Day with the proceeds to go to the general fund, however, a recording taking place as to the exact amount. Could I have a vote on that then, if we have a motion and a
second?
Okay, that's unanimous, 7-0 on that amendment. Any other changes necessary in the item 134? I can't remember. Did we have
a motion to amend?
We can't vote on an amendment without a motion.
Major motion.
I thought we had the motion.
I moved.
Phyllis moved it, and it was a second.
Your statement.
Yeah, but, so you moved the approving all of these dates?
No, just the amendment.
Just your amendment.
But we can't amend some.
You have to.
We have no motion before us to amend.
That's right, we don't have a motion.
Right.
That's right.
Okay, you're right.
Okay, I'll move then that we approve the dates.
Okay, there is a motion now to approve the dates as set forth.
Second.
Although, any discussion?
I just had one question, Chairman Krillman, if Clint could come up just for a sec, just for. The Cape Elizabeth Little League, have they historically been playing at the fort in the various fields? I think last year, wasn't there, was there another league that wanted to play at a certain time? Can you recall that at all?
We've not given any approval for any other league to play there, just the Cape Little League. I did have comment from one Little League coach today. I was on the phone, and they had made a comment. They had girls softball, and there was a group from Lewiston down playing on the softball field, and they wouldn't get off the field when we had, and they said it was an open park, and everybody had the right to be there. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, we've approved Little League to be there. You can knock, you know, take them off the field anytime you want to. And he didn't quite understand that, and they waited, made stood there for a while, waited, all the girls stood around watching these guys play softball, and they finally left and they took over. But I'm not aware of any other league that we've ever given approval to be there, including a girls' women's softball league. I think they had talked about it some years ago, I think. I don't think that ever got off the ground. I don't remember that totally.
Councilor Pearson, I think what you're referring to is that there is a regular season for the Little League in Cape Elizabeth, and then there's a sort of a special addendum at the end of the regular season that two or three teams pick up together and go the rest of the summer. And there had been a request put before us by that, I perhaps call it a bit of the unofficial Little League that went through the summer, and we did not grant approval for that.
That's what I was trying to get at.
All right, right. On. That's a group. I don't. If that's the group you're talking about, that's a group of young men of roughly 8 to 10 years of age. It's more or less a pickup group that plays. They work with Little League, but they can't be approved by Little League because Little League closes off at a certain period of time. But it's basically all Little League people doing it. Just a chance for the kids to play baseball during the summer instead of stopping in June 15th or July 1st.
I just wanted a clarification so that there wasn't any.
No, the Little League is something that's always traditionally been there, and we certainly feel free in having them be there.
Okay.
And that's great.
Yeah. No, I have no problems. I just wanted to make sure we didn't set any kind of offsetting precedent. Thank you.
Okay. Councilor Amaral.
Yes, I'd like to move that we amend the proposal before us regarding Family Fun Day to read that the $2 parking fee, the proceeds from the $2 parking fee will go to the general fund, but an account will be set up to record the amount of money which is received as a result of that parking fee.
Do you want to add to your amendment the date on the back on the 20th?
The rain date.
The rain date?
Yes.
That
and
might
also,
be a good idea.
Right. Amend under the British car show, add September 20th as the rain date for the British car show.
I'll second.
Okay, we have the motion and the second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Okay, 7-0.
Is that on the
amendment?
That's on the amendment, right. Now, we need to vote on the item.
Vote on the motion.
Can I have a motion, please?
We have one.
Okay, and a second?
Yep.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Okay, thank you very much. 7-0, I think procedurally, I think we did it the right way. Okay, item number 135 this evening is to consider authorizing the expenditure of up to $1,500 from the existing fire department budget for the replacement of the curbs and sidewalk at the public safety building and take any necessary action. And I will defer to Ms. Pizzo at this time.
Thank you very much. I hope that the council did have a chance to go over to the public safety building and look at the curb and the sidewalk. Specifically, it's on the side of the building where you enter the police department, and it rounds the corner where the policemen themselves enter the building. As you can see, the curbing is literally coming apart, and I believe it's called rebar that's coming up through the curbing. The manager has two specific concerns, and the first of which is a safety issue. Again, when you go around there, you can easily trip. And the second is that we are not in compliance with the Americans with Disabilities Act for the handicap accessibility. And taking these two things into consideration, he would strongly recommend that you authorize the $1,500 expenditure.
Councilor McLaughlin?
I will move that we authorize the expenditure of up to $1,500 from the existing fire department budget. And I'd like it to go for the replacement of the curbs and sidewalk, and also for the bottom step going.
We have to wait till spring, but that's part of the plan.
Oh, that doesn't have to be here?
The board's
directing on that. Okay. Okay, scratch that. We're going to get that bottom step. So for the replacement of the curbs and sidewalk at the public safety building.
Okay, we have a motion, a second.
Second.
We have a motion, a second. Discussion. Councilor Jordan.
I'd just like to say that I'm in favor of the fixing this up, because I took a look at it. But I'm not in favor of the way the money has come forward. I think if you're going to have it done, just to take a guesstimate, it takes me back to the highway new garage deal. I still say it was $400,000 use that was on the motion here, and I'll stick to it till the day I die. But they went over it. Now you've got $1,500 here. And I wish the manager was here so I could argue with him on it instead of doing it with, because it isn't fair with the acting town manager. But the project needs to be done. I don't disagree with it. I think there's a part of it that could be done with the public works, and I think there could be some money saved there because they could take the old stuff out and have somebody come in and put the new down. And I think we could have an adequate project. And I feel that's the way it should be done.
Thank you, Councillor. Other input on this item? Councillor McLaughlin?
I'll question Mrs. Pizzo based on Councillor Jordan's comments. Do you know if Public Works is, if we anticipate any assistance from Public Works with this project?
I do not know. I know that there are two bids, I believe, that have been received, but I've not been told that Public Works would be included on the project.
It may be for this small a job that a contractor would not want to bid unless they get the whole thing. I mean, this isn't a very large, I don't know either. Thank you.
Any other discussion?
All those in favor?
All those opposed? The vote is 6-1. The vote carries. Thank you very much. Next is item 136, is to consider a memorandum from the town manager regarding sewer connections and take any action. Well, I told Michael that I would address this particular issue in a sense in his behalf, as he wasn't going to be here. I'm not going to read the entire page. Well, maybe I will. No, I've just decided I am going to read the entire page. I think that will give the citizens a sense as to where the town manager is coming from regarding sewer policy. This is a memorandum to the town council from the town manager regarding sewer policy dated February 24, 1992. It has been apparent for some time that the current policy for allowing development to occur in areas adjacent to sewers without the benefit of sewers needs to be addressed. During the early 1980s, the town adopted a sewer facilities plan which provided for, in quotation marks, fill-in growth, and quotation marks. This was subsequently defined as only those lots with frontage on an existing gravity sewer line with no provision for sewering additional neighborhoods or lots without direct frontage of such a sewer line. This policy has worked well in that it has preserved sewer capacity. However, it did not meet the objective, which was foremost in the minds of the public in the early 1980s, which was to ensure that public sewers would not become an engine for growth. We have all seen that growth has occurred regardless of the availability of sewer. The restrictive sewer policy will very likely cause long-term costs for the community. Specifically, at some time in the future, non-sewered areas are likely to petition the town for sewers. If sewers are not provided, then residents would have significant more costs. Many argue that everyone would be better off if developers paid for sewers as part of the original infrastructure instead of all sewer rate payers having to assume the burden in the future. I raise the issue at this time because resolving the issue of sewer availability and sewer capacity is the town council's highest priority goal for the current fiscal council year. It is also timely, as addressing the issue is part of the implementation process for the comprehensive plan. After much consideration, my proposal is extremely direct and is intended to serve as an impetus for much further discussion and debate. Specifically, I recommend the following. Growth areas as outlined in the comprehensive plan and as needing further delineation by the town council and the planning board should be permitted to connect to the public sewer. Developers should be allowed to connect at their own expense as many units in growth areas as are permitted to be built in conformance with existing zoning regulations. That is the memorandum that the town manager provided the council for consideration this evening. And basically, it's intended to serve as an impetus for further discussion. So where we take this memorandum is basically up to us. We can refer it back to the sewer, to the ordinance committee. We do that regularly. We can decide to have a workshop and address it as a particular issue, or there are other, perhaps, options that we can entertain. Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Chairman Creelman. I'd like to recommend, on behalf of the Appointments Committee, because this issue has gotten much discussion during our appointments process, I would make a motion that we refer this issue to the Board of Sewer Appeals for their review and that their recommendations be forwarded post haste to the Ordinance Committee for their review and perusal.
Okay, there's a motion. I think I heard a second to my left. Is there further discussion on this item? Councilor Jordan?
I yield to the lady.
Councilor Rama, please.
I'd like to ask the Sewer Appeals Board to look at existing capacity also and to see what kind of effect this policy would have on our capacity. Because I like the idea, but I want to make sure that we're not going to get ourselves in a situation where we're going to have to build a new treatment plant before too long.
Okay. Councilor Jordan?
I agree with what Councilor Emmer was saying. Also, I'm very much in favor of this because this has been one of my thorn in my side for quite a few years that people weren't able to hook on. They turn around and put a leaching field in. Now we're looking for them to hook on. I said years ago that if we didn't have it so people could hook on to the sewer, have the capacity, that the town or the ratepayers weren't going to be able to afford the sewer. And it's heading that direction because we've gone up every year for the last 3 years on those people, and I think it's time we take a look at it. Now, whether there's will be any funds in the future, and this is a good project for the committee to look at, or to redo some of the sewers that are already in town that we know have a problem of leaking, and that we could fix some of them, and then you would have your added capacity without going and working on your treatment plants. I know both of them are pretty well up to capacity, but I think the whole issue needs to be looked at and that we can pick up some of these people. When I think of the two projects especially that wanted to hook up to the sewer and they weren't allowed, and finally they allowed two or three of them to hook up, and they've only got two other ones that could hook up now that was built previously that are on leasing fields. And I think it's wrong. It shouldn't have been done then. When you have the contractors there and they're ready to do it for you, that's the time to do it. Now you're going to have the ratepayers doing it in the town, and that's going to be a thorn in a lot of people's side.
Thank you, Councilor Cogsell.
Do we need to give this Board of Sewer Appeals some sort of deadline so that it won't take 2 years to complete the study? We have a lot of background information already done with our engineers as far as capacity and infiltration. What would be a reasonable expectation? I know you, Councilor Chapel, don't like overly restrictive deadlines, but what do you think might be considered?
Thank you.
No, I just sort of want a consensus from the group. Is October?
No, if they're going to look at it, you ought to give them 3 months.
At least.
At least. Okay.
Preliminary report by July, at the July council meeting. Might work.
That would be fair, I think.
Could we have the original motion amended to reflect that addition?
I'll also amend or allow such amendment to be made.
Could we have an allowance for the second? Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's a deadline of sorts there. Councilor McLaughlin.
When you were discussing the agenda items with the manager, did he only have a number one for this? He rarely does that. I wondered if there was...
There is a page two.
Oh, could we be enlightened about what
I've made a note to get that to you.
Oh, we don't know what's on page two? We don't know what we're referring
you don't,
to these
but
people?
I
could surmise.
Could we be enlightened by Mrs. Pizzo, please, what it is we're actually referring to this committee? I want the rest of the story.
Is it 2, 3, and 4? Shall I read?
Items 2, 3, and 4, you mean.
Well, yes. Wayne...
He read one.
One, right. It,
Mike got completely cut off.
We all only got one.
I didn't
Mine
go.
Two,
I didn't
I
go
had
any.
To go back because
okay.
I thought there was.
Thank
more.
You for your diligence.
Okay. Number two is all sewer connection fees shall go into a fund dedicated to the removal of infiltration into public sewer lines. Number three, outside growth areas, the existing sewer connection policies should remain in place. Number four, all sewer ordinance provisions relating to sewer connection should be rewritten in plain English. Up to this point, I have not expended municipal funds to have the town engineer study this proposal. I look forward to hearing the council's discussion on sewer policy and recommend that you involve the Board of Sewer Appeals, the Conservation Commission, and the Planning Board as you proceed on this issue. Perhaps a joint workshop to solicit initial thoughts may be appropriate.
Thank you.
Well, without seeing the second page, it looks like we are of somewhat one mind on this one, despite the general impetus. Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Chairman Creelman. The only caution I would put forth, and I think this is right up Councilor Chapel's alley, is that such strong directives biases a committee from coming up with, I think, a broad-based approach to letting them have the initiative of looking at what they feel is in place and give the same direction to the Conservation Commission, Planning Board, and any others that might be involved without prejudicing their efforts by making such strong direction, telling them what should be done, because that's a directive and everything's done if that's directed out. I think that the mind of this, especially the Board of Sewer Appeals, is in the right track that they wanted to review that for the past 4 years. And I don't think that direction that was alluded to on page two should be so forceful, because it's cut out their work.
Well, I don't really consider it, Carl, a directive. I think there are four areas that the town manager has suggested at some point will need to be addressed. I think the issue is putting a priority on sewer policy, and the restrictive policy that we have now is not working well, and it needs to be relooked at.
I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to tie up the hands either of anybody on the Board of Sewer Appeals.
No, leave the directive at that point. without putting his suggestions, because he'll be at that meeting anyways and then can add that input. But to add that into any directive that we give to them, I think is improper.
Well, I didn't even, I'm sorry, but I wasn't under the impression that we were even adding the first directive. We were just referring it.
No, just referring it to. Yeah. But just with that note, I mean, Michael's not here. But.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's going to bother us, Mr. Chairman, as long as we're careful in our amendment. I think in our motion, I think we've done that. We're referring it to the Sewer Appeals Board, and mm-hmm. they don't know anything about 1 through 4. If we put that in as part of their thing, then we'd be giving them definite guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we can take care of that,
all right. Mm-hmm. Councilor McLaughlin.
One definite guideline we do have, however, is the comprehensive plan. Mm-hmm. And I think it's appropriate to direct them to make their recommendations within the intent of the comprehensive plan.
Mm-hmm.
I think that could be an overall direction to them and let them, as Councilor Coggeshall said, we have a lot of material that they can avail themselves of, and I'm sure they will, but I think the guiding force is the comprehensive.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Ramro.
I think our instincts were right also to send this to the Sewer Appeals Board first, mm-hmm. and then when they come back with their ideas, then I think we can get other boards involved. But mm-hmm. I want to give them the first shot at it.
Councilor Jordan.
I agree with them. I think they should have the first shot, and I think they would go to these different boards and have a joint meeting or what have you. Let's give them some reins to do some thinking and not try to sit here and tell them you do 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All right, all those in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. Okay, item number 137 is to consider a proposed policy regarding foreclosed commercial properties and take any necessary action. Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you very much. Up to this point, the Town Council has never had a written policy regarding foreclosed commercial properties. It was the wish of the Council to explore and review this issue. Tonight, you will find in your summary of recommendations, the manager has recommended a policy be followed. First of all, if any commercial property is foreclosed upon, that the tax collector shall notify the Town Council through an agenda item on the next regular Town Council agenda. And secondly, the Town Council may direct the tax collector to have a tax auction sale of the property in conformance with 36 MRSA as may be amended. I do need to note for you this evening that the town manager apologizes that he could not give you a more detailed report on foreclosed property due to the budget in the Water District hearing. His time has been consumed with those two issues. He has, however, recommended that you authorize me to secure an opinion from the town attorney on this tax sale. Currently, we have a foreclosed property located on Shore Road. The town attorney would be able to give us a list of options. The manager is quite concerned that this statute is very lengthy and it's very complicated, and he wants to make sure that, of course, we do proceed properly. Also, I will be contacting the municipal legal staff for information to help us out as well.
The only addition I would make in that, again, is there is a misword, and it's the recommendation is that you authorize the acting town manager to secure from the town attorney, not to serve. So to secure or obtain was the intent of that that paragraph. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This item is more or less a follow-up to an item we had last month listing the recently foreclosed properties. As Mrs. Pizzo mentioned, we did have just one commercial property on that list. There has been a discussion by the council in a workshop session since the February meeting about this situation, and I'll speak for myself, not the rest of the council. I do find it a very serious situation when we have any foreclosed properties, but especially with a commercial property where I have, unless I've been given different information, which in this case I haven't, I have to assume that there is some income being generated by the commercial property, and then I start questioning, well, why isn't some of that income being used to pay off the taxes? I do appreciate the complexities of the state regulations concerning this. I know we've been caught in the past by some of the finer points, I guess, of some of the state regulations in dealing with foreclosures, and I believe that's probably why the manager is suggesting we have some input from the town attorney on this. I'm glad to hear that we'll be getting, or at least requesting information from MMA about this. I don't think we need to reinvent the wheel of the procedures for our town to follow, but we do certainly need to make sure that we're in compliance with all the legalities that are required. I think it would serve us well and potentially help us with our revenue situation if we do proceed with the legal steps that we need to make sure we can do it in as timely a manner as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Chairman Perelman. I'm just a little dismayed that we didn't have information on foreclosed property prior to a date of foreclosure and or subsequent action. I think that there's plenty of notice when a property has been foreclosed, because it is a certain time that passes, if I'm correct, before such action does occur. And I would think that an opinion could have been rendered prior to, because essentially I think you're giving anyone that is delinquent and in foreclosure a freebie to say, you've got another 30 days, why would wait and come up with this opinion. I think it's happened many other times and places, and I think that it should have been done a little more quickly as far as the opinions and whatnot. That's just personal feeling. Thank you.
Thank you. Council.
I'm not prepared tonight to recommend a general policy. I think we need input from our town attorney before we draft an actual policy.
Mr. Chairman?
Please.
Going along with that, what Councilor Coggeshall said, I think we've got to be very careful that we treat all properties that we put liens on the same way. I don't care whether they're commercial or whether they're individual homes. I think when you put a lien on for a property, unless things have changed from when I was in that business, why, if that lien, they can make up that payment anytime within that first year after the lien is put on. You do not take the property till 365 days after you put the lien on. Then it becomes the property of the town. Now, if any of these properties, a lien has been on for that 365 days, they're automatically our property. We don't need any permission from anybody to sell them. I think what we're trying to do here, possibly, is that lien been on that piece of property for a full year?
It's actually 18 months
18
from
months.
The date
well,
of the,
wrong.
18, right,
18
months.
Have been.
Absolutely.
So now they're our property.
Absolutely.
We're carrying them on the, and now we've got to find out what rights we have to do with them.
Correct.
Okay. I'll go along with Carl then. I can't understand it. I'm sorry.
Well, again, there's been nothing in place in the past, and frankly, we've never had to deal with
okay.
it.
Okay, right. So in other words, we're starting, this is a new policy for the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Right.
So therefore, I go right back to Councilor McCaughlin's. Yes, we authorize you, as far as I'm concerned, to find out as fast as you can what the law says and what we are able to do, and then we can write a policy,
right.
Not until we know.
Right.
You follow me? That's the way I feel that.
Okay, is there we have a motion.
No.
I believe, no, we
no.
don't have a motion.
Make it.
Could
the
we have a motion?
We authorize the acting town manager to secure from the town attorney an opinion on the town's rights on these properties that we have acquired by lien, all of them.
Second motion.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. Further discussion. Councilor McLaughlin.
As long as Mrs. Pizzo understands that is to include the tax auction sale.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's intended.
Does that include number one and two of
the policy in the summary of recommendations.
Counselor Council?
We're authorizing her to obtain information relating to those two steps.
Yes, not to do anything.
But not for us to form a policy, but, okay. Make that clear.
Mm-hmm. Authorizing one and two also.
For you to pursue information on those two.
We did not authorize one and two.
No, we're not authorizing one and two. We're simply authorizing, starting the third paragraph. You authorize the acting town manager, and then from then on, everything above that, we're not authorizing. So that's the motion.
That's correct.
Simply to obtain an opinion as soon as possible as to what our options are.
That is correct.
Regarding the possible tax auction sale.
If the, I would think if the manager wants to formulate a policy for us to consider at our next meeting, that might be appropriate, but I don't think that needs to be part of the motion.
Mm-hmm.
That could be an agenda item next month.
Mm-hmm. Counselor Pearson?
Yes, Chairman Cronin. I just hope that any opinion offered by the town attorney be made known to the council as soon as it's made, not waiting to a next meeting, even if it requires a special meeting. I just think on certain circumstances relative to these situations that I think we've been a little lax in pursuing it, in all fairness to any other property owners that pay their taxes. And once again, I want to be notified as soon as the opinion is made. And if a special agenda has to be made on a special council meeting, it be done. Now, I'm not saying that that's an addendum to the motion, but just for the record, to be known my discontent once again on these particular issues.
Okay, so noted. Yeah, we do have a motion. We have a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Okay, this is a 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. Okay, the next item is item 138, and this is to consider acknowledging receipt of the proposed fiscal year 1993 budget and take any necessary action. I'll defer to Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you very much. Although I cannot speak for the town manager, nor will I try, I have a couple of comments. The recommended budget that was sent, I believe, last Friday to the town council was a $4.1 million municipal budget. It is 3.5% more spent than 2 years ago. This would require a 68-cent per thousand tax increase, or 4.2% above the aggregate tax rate of $16.60. This budget would still, per capita, we would be the second lowest of all area suburban communities. This budget would also still be less than one quarter of the total tax rate. I hope you keep in mind when you review this budget that Cape Elizabeth was on the forefront in cutting expenditures to brace for the economic recession. We saw this in FY92. The budgets are lean. We've already experienced cuts in maintenance in the infrastructure, deferral of equipment replacements, etc. At this time, we do need to move ahead. The manager does see some positive signs, and deferred equipment and maintenance and so forth will only cost more in the end. Any cuts in this budget will impact services, maintenance, etc. I do encourage the public to come to Town Hall to receive a copy of this budget. I encourage everyone to read carefully the town manager's cover letter that he did prepare. The town manager and department heads do look forward to working with the town council during this budget process, and I would recommend that you refer it on to the finance committee.
Thank you very much, Ms. Pizzo. Well, do we want to tackle it tonight, or? Counselor Amaro.
Just one comment. I thought it was interesting the way the manager referred to this budget as being a 3.5% increase over our budget of 2 years ago. I'd really like to see what the percentage of increase is over last year's budget.
Okay.
I couldn't find it.
We will get that number.
But with that, I will move that we acknowledge receipt of this proposed fiscal year 1993 budget and send it to the Finance Committee.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
Just, I need to let the rest of the councilors know while we're discussing the budget. In my capacity as chairman of the Finance Committee, I have had a couple of discussions with Peter Leslie, who's chair of the School Board Finance Committee. And these discussions took place subsequent to their meeting last Thursday evening. I believe that was their last meeting. He reported they found themselves in quite a bit of a quandary. They have two major uncertainties with their budget situation right now. One of those being the amount of state funding that they will receive. The other being the outcome of negotiations. One of those is very unusual, the state funding situation. The other situation is not as unusual. I suggested that they finish their budget deliberations and come up with a budget to pass on to the council. I understood and repeated to him that the council had not yet set an amount or percentage of increase that we were expecting from the school board. Therefore, our process would be somewhat different than it was last year, and suggest that they pass on their budget to the council with everybody having a full understanding that it was going to be subject to revisions both after council deliberation on it and after potential for the school board review of the budget. The school board budget will not be cast in granite when it is passed on to the council. Just as what we're receiving tonight is the manager's budget, that neither is cast in granite. We're going to take it and massage it and do a few other things to it. Probably I can see a twinkle in Council Chapel's eye already. Can't wait to get his teeth into it. And I will echo what Mrs. Pizzo said about inviting public input. I think that's going to be really important this year. We will take input from people at public hearing. We will also take input in writing and echo her urging of people to come in and make themselves familiar with the budget. Call counselors if you have questions about it, and feel very welcome to call the staff also.
Thank you. It's always good to have a place to start. We have a place to start. We also have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Okay, 7-0. Thank you very much. Item 139 this evening is to consider the Democratic Town Committee's nomination of an alternate member to serve on the Board of Voter Registration and take any necessary action. Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you very much. There has been a change in Title 21A of the election laws that requires an alternate to both the Republican and Democratic member of the Board of Voter Registration if that individual cannot serve in his or her capacity. If you will recall, you did approve the alternate to the Republican board last month. You should have received in your packet a letter from the Democratic Town Committee, and I would recommend that you nominate Penelope P. Carson to serve as an alternate on that board.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. 7-0. Item number 140 is to consider authorizing a quitclaim deed to Hazel R. Kelly for land and buildings on map U07, lot 23 in Delano Park, and take any necessary action. Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you. We did foreclose on this property on January 24, 1992 for unpaid 1990 real estate taxes. I have since received a certified bank check in the amount of $4,413.74. This would pay the real estate taxes on this account through June 30th. I would recommend that you authorize me to sign the quitclaim.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Item 141 is to consider a proposed sexual harassment policy and take any necessary action. Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you. The town manager has included in your packet a sexual harassment policy. This would put us in conformance with a new state law. I would recommend that you approve this.
So moved.
Second for the comment. Only thing I can say, I guess I got to be careful what I say to my neighbor here.
That's right.
I got
Counselor Amaro.
Just a question of the acting town manager. Has our town attorney reviewed this policy?
I am not aware that he has. However, I can check.
I think it might be a good idea before we adopt this policy that it be reviewed by our town attorney.
So we had a motion. We had a second. Are we looking to amend that motion pending review, or is the motion to be first reviewed by the town attorney before going into policy language?
It would be my feeling that we ought to have the town attorney's opinion as to whether this does indeed conform to the state requirements before we enact the policy.
Counselor
that may have been done. We don't know that.
I did not ask that question myself. Counselor Coxall?
I concur with Counselor Amaro, or if this policy was derived from something from the Maine Municipal Association and their legal staff, that would also be appropriate.
Yes, right.
I think it must have been checked over, or it wouldn't have been, they wouldn't have already had meetings on it here in town, I don't think, if they're using the policy already. Is that right? Acting town manager, this policy has already been discussed by departments and...
The training that we had that is required was by the police chief, which he, I believe, for his department has a policy, and I believe that's what our training was based on.
So you used that one?
Correct.
At that time?
At that time.
So Jane is absolutely right. It would be nice before we say this is the policy to have it checked out.
Mr. Chairman, I would withdraw my second, and so we could get a new motion, because I'm inclined to agree with Counselor Amaro.
Is it possible to recast the original motion, given the second's been withdrawn?
I'm comfortable that we accept the policy as written, with the stipulation that it go by the manager to the town attorney for his approval. Not approved, why it comes back to us.
Well, that's a tough one, Counselor McLaughlin.
See if there's a second.
I'm sorry. All right.
Is that a motion?
Yeah, unless you want to change it, I'm perfectly willing. I know what I want to say.
Counselor Amaro, I don't hear a second. I'm going to let you speak.
Okay. I'd like to suggest that we send this policy to the town attorney or to the legal staff of Maine Municipal Association for its review and its recommendation to the town council.
Do I hear a second? I'll second the motion.
Okay. The only problem we have with that, we don't know whether the manager is already done it. So I would like to just refer it to the next month of May or something like that and make sure that he does it in the meantime. We need the city and the town to go to the lawyers again.
I'll withdraw my second.
I'll withdraw my motion. That's a much better answer.
Okay. Yeah. Billy, are you making a motion to table it till the following council meeting in April?
That would be my motion.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. Item number 142 is to consider the appointment of a sealer of weights and measures for 1992 and take any necessary action. Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you. During the past 5 years, Chief Webster had served the sealers of weights and measures. At this time, the manager would recommend that you appoint Keith R. Sherrard as our sealer of weights and measures for the calendar year 1992. Mr. Sherrard is the sealer in the city of South Portland. He does have expertise in this field, and I would recommend that you authorize his appointment.
So moved.
So moved. We have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Item 143 is to consider resolving that the town enter into a revised funds transfer agreement with Key Bank and take any necessary action. As you have all reviewed prior to this evening, the Key Bank of Maine February 7th letter, and also Schedule A. My understanding was that Phyllis had requested the entire document for us this evening that we have before us, pages 1 through 5. The town manager had basically given us the kind of the bottom line. Councilor Cogsill has given us the in between. Now we have it all. I don't know if everyone has had a opportunity to read the funds transfer agreement. It looked like a standard agreement. Councilor Cogsill.
I just want to ask my fellow councilors, according to this agreement, it's possible via telephone with a recording of the telephone conversation to transfer up to $300,000 without any kind of a security code or verification. And I just wondered if this was how you felt about having that amount of money transferred that way. And nowhere in the document is there any reference to a type of security code or verification procedure.
Excuse me, if I may, Councilor Newman. Just a clarification, when the business manager does call for a wire on money, they do have to call back. Either Mrs. Ray, Mr. McGovern, or myself have to verify that transfer. It is with the TRN numbers, as they call them, and we also have our PIN numbers, if that helps you.
But it doesn't say that in this agreement.
Okay.
But, I'm sorry.
Councilor Pearson.
I just, not looking over this either. I didn't even have time to read it, because I was just wondering what, I imagine safeguards are in there, but as far as transfers, any kind of electronic transfers, it's easy to have even the PIN numbers back and forth. But are there restrictions in wire transfers as far as where the money is transferred to? In other words, from a CD account to a town account, no problem. But I mean, you know, where can this be transferred to or from for the proper identification? I'm just a little, without reading it and not knowing about the liability for erroneous transfer or unauthorized transfer, I'm just a little uncomfortable without knowing what the policy has been in the past, what safeguards might be in place.
Well, I'm not a banker. I don't know if anyone on the council here has the expertise to address if in the language of paragraph 3 on verification of payment orders, in reading through that, it seemed that the verification representative verified a variety of things in that process. If there's a step there that we need to introduce, then my sense is that we're going to have to table this item also this evening to get clarification next month on it. Otherwise, we just pass it as a standard business agreement.
If I just may, for a clarification, I did talk to the manager about this agreement, knowing that Councilor Cogsill had requested the backup information, and he did want me to note, if it did come up, that if this is not signed, then basically we technically cannot transfer money to Key Bank, and currently we have $800,000 in repos and CDs with Key Bank. So I just wanted to point that out.
Mr. Chairman.
Please, Councilor Chappell.
I can see no reason for not authorizing the acting town manager to sign this agreement, because it's standard. 7 and 8 gives you your liability for unauthorized transfers. 8 gives you liability for erroneous transfers. It's all covered all the way down through. There's absolutely no chance whatsoever in ever happening that the town would lose any money by signing this agreement. It's a standard agreement, and it's used by every town in the state of Maine.
Is that a motion?
Yeah, I'll move the
second.
The acting town manager to sign this agreement.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion.
Is it standard for up to $300,000 without a written? Okay.
All those in favor? The vote is 7-0. Did you vote on that one?
No.
The vote is 6 And against this motion?
Yes, I'm just, once again, I'm uncomfortable without, I was when I first read it, and I haven't had time to digest any of this, so I'll remain the lone one.
Okay, the vote is 6 in favor, 1 against on this particular motion. Okay, at this point, we have an opportunity for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Would anyone like to address any particular item this evening? Okay, seeing nobody going to take that one up, I will then move to the issue of adjournment.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor? Thank you very much, and thank you very much for all citizens watching us this evening. Good night.
Do you want to talk about the IWS workshop?